Hi, everybody. Welcome back to ASIS Security Snapshots, where each week we profile a member of the ASIS security community. Today's topic, Hurricane Preparedness, Response, and Recovery. I'm your host, the security guy, Chuck Harold. Please welcome my next guest, Mr. Anthony Hurley, CPP, PCI, and PSP. He's a steering committee member of the ASIS Utilities Security Community. Mr. Anthony, welcome to the show, my friend.
Thank you, and thank you for the invitation.
Now, we're talking about hurricane preparedness out here in Arizona, not a problem. That's my preparedness plan living here, because I would not want anything to do with a hurricane. I'll take earthquakes in California and 120 degrees, but this is a serious problem and has serious ramifications if we're not prepared for it. So I'm really glad we're going over this because the hurricane season is rapidly approaching. Give us an idea. What is the most important aspect to hurricane preparedness?
Well, second to none is safety, both the safety of the personnel that work the hurricanes and also of the general public. If you take a look at any of the utilities, they have initiatives and protocols in place to make sure that they're able to go out there very quickly, assess, and be able to isolate anything that could pose a danger to the general public. And then the workers, it is just so important to talk to the workers, make sure they understand the operation, because when they're working long hours in some areas that maybe they're not familiar with, it's very, very critical that you keep them focused on safety.
Now, you've worked for a utility, electric utility, for 37 years. What has changed in the time you've been on board here as far as preparedness, awareness, that sort of thing?
Well, to give you an idea, back in, I think it was the 1990s, we did some research and found that in our utility, about 30 to 40% of the personnel were actually engaged with restoration. That has changed, where today, everybody in a utility has a job. We go back, we either the position that they currently are in, or maybe some training they've had in the past, or individuals that have been with volunteer fire departments or military that know very, very specific some skill sets. Everybody has a job when you take a look at most utilities. The other issue is going forward, you have to take a look at the technology advances. Today, you have applications that give you the best routes. They tell you when bridges are closed, even to the point where they can tell you if restaurants are going to be open by the time you get there, or even fuel stations. There's applications that are being worked on to let you know how much fuel is there and is there diesel fuel, which is usually what we end up using. And then you have to take a look at some of the tools that are being used, such as drones. Down in the Virgin Islands, we were able to utilize drones for many tasks. Instead of having to go into an area that has been washed out or maybe there's conductors down, now you can use a drone to do assessment and have that information right at your fingertips.
All right, so here's what I'm hearing about technology. It is great for preparation, but seems like we're using it more in real-time response. In other words, we're able to shift things on the fly and get real-time data that we never had available before. That must be very life-saving.
Yeah, when you take a look at the utility's mission, it's really about helping the communities recover. And I'll give you a real-life example. We one time were en route going to a hurricane in one of the Gulf states. We were not notified that a bridge was out. It was damaged. We could not cross it because, again, we probably had 100 very heavy trucks, vehicles, and equipment, and we had to reroute. That reroute cost us several hours, and instead of us being able to get to the location we were going to be in, where we would actually bed down for the night, we were actually several hours short of reaching that location. So from a logistics perspective, it was something we had to hurry up and find hotels for a lot of personnel. In a location that we didn't think we would be at. And that host company did not have our resources the next morning where they could put it into their planning schedule. So today, when we would go out of town, we have that information. We know if a bridge is not operating, we know if a roadway is damaged, and we can plan our reroute and then give the host company estimates of when we're going to arrive. The technology, you know, you also talked about preparedness. Some of the information that is now available when you do your estimated damage, where you can look at what area you think is going to flood, how deep the water is going to be. It gives you the ability to do a lot of different mitigation measures well in advance, and maybe enables you not even to have to respond to that particular emergency because now you've mitigated it.
Are we finding that with this shift in technology, the workers are not becoming part of the rescue mission, right? In other words, they're going in there to save people, but they have to maintain safety themselves. Otherwise, the whole mission kind of fails.
Yeah, absolutely. We don't want to multiply the issue for the first responders that have to go out there and save lives. And again, we do a lot of planning before we even get to a location. If it's your utility that's impacted, there's a lot of planning in regards to damage assessment, knowing what we're going to be getting into. We like to send the right size crew, the right type of crew to the right location the first time with the right material. From a productivity perspective, it gives us the ability to restore. And then we also use that to estimate when we're going to have an area recovered so then we can start informing customers who need that estimated restoration time when they're going to have power back on. Like the other utilities, when we've worked with them, same thing. They then can put an estimate when water is going to be back, when a wastewater treatment plant is going to be back online. But yes, we are very, very careful about our planning. And again, the safety of the personnel is just critical.
Walk me through, as a security consultant, what you're going to advise your clients. Maybe give me a hierarchy. Hey, number one thing you got to do is this. Number two, like maybe what are the top five things you would advise on?
The top five is one, I would make sure that they have an updated plan. I say updated because it's not unusual to go into a client where you look at the plan and it's 10, 15 years old. I've even had a client that has provided me their existing plan. It was actually typed. It wasn't even on a computer. I would say secondly is to make sure that everybody knows what that plan is. Because a plan on a shelf, as robust as it is, and unless it's in the hands of the personnel, it's not really going to do anybody any good. Preparation is critical. So exercise. You have a very large, talented, core of individuals out there who can respond to these emergencies. They need an opportunity to exercise and to be able to know what decision-making they have to do. Next is to reach out with all the partners, the public-private partnership. In the past, again, you could be sitting next to somebody from FEMA, or you could be sitting next to somebody from Department of Energy or the Army Corps of Engineers. If it's a natural emergency, and then if it's any other type of emergency, let's say some type of intentional criminal act, you may be sitting next to the state police and the FBI. Again, it's critical to have those relationships and keep them and keep those relationships intact. And then I'd say the last one is just understand that it's a mission. You have to plan. You have to be very methodical in how you execute. And you have to realize that there are limitations. You can only get done what you can get done. And if you don't keep your eye on the ultimate goal of recovering the community, that's usually when the plans basically fall apart.
Yeah, we're rapidly moving into hurricane season and, unfortunately, the next flu COVID season, if you want to call it that. Has anything shifted in your approach to this? It's just added a new layer of complexity to the planning.
Yes, absolutely. So with everything that's going on out there, I think that utility companies have worked together and coming up with plans to address some of the situations that we're currently having to address, COVID, flu season. One of the things that's critical is really the associations. When I think of the electric sector, Edison Electric Institute, NRECA, and the Co-op Association, and also the association that is part of the municipal systems, APPA, have all done a very good job of putting this information together and sending that information out and sharing it. And then even other sectors, spent my career in the electric, but the American Waterworks Association and so many other organizations are all working together to make sure that they do what they have to do to make sure that people are going to be safe, they're going to be available, and that, again, they don't contribute to a larger problem in the future.
Mr. Anthony, you walk the walk and talk, my friend. You speak with authority, and I got to say, I would love to be in your sector if something happens, because I think you got it under control. Thanks so much for coming on Security Snapshots, my friend.
Thank you very much, and be safe out there.